May I have your attention, please? Please feel free to come up here and sit along the side. I am Dr. Joyce Latner, Vice President for Academic Affairs. I want to welcome Dr. Molefi Asante to our campus. The Academic Affairs Distinguished Lecture Series brings to the Howard University campus outstanding individuals who are on the cutting edge of issues and events that are shaping our lives and our contemporary learning environments. These lectures are part of a process that only begins when students and other members of the university community come to the chapel to hear the speaker. I hope that you will embrace the series as part of an ongoing intellectual process that will impart values, that will stimulate your discussions in your classrooms, that will cause you to take a look at yourself as a whole human being and examine some of the issues and problems that you are personally confronting, as well as confronting in your educational years here at Howard University. Take the ideas that are shared by these speakers and translate them into plans and into activities that will help you to become better people. Hopefully, you will continue to explore the ideas that are presented by the lecturers in the context of your academic and personal lives. The lecture series is a part of what I define as mutual responsibility between the university and the students. As Chief Academic Officer of the university, I see this as an opportunity for the university to provide to you, the students, and to the faculty and other members of our community, a forum for intellectual stimulation and enrichment while you fulfill your part of this mutual responsibility, but not just coming to satisfy a class assignment, but more importantly, by searching for inspiration and relevant applications in your personal lives. I'd like to, at this point, recognize Dean Orlando Taylor of the School of Communications. Dean Taylor, will you stand? I recognize Dean Taylor because he is not only a professional colleague of long standing of our speakers, but he is also a personal friend, and he assisted us in bringing Dr. Asante to the campus. Dr. Molefi Asante is an internationally renowned scholar in the fields of African studies, African American studies, and intercultural communications. His writings on Afrocentricity have played a significant role in the current debate relating to multicultural education in America. Dr. Asante is recognized as the nation's leading African American scholar in speech communication. His subspecialty is intercultural communication. Dr. Asante has directly been involved in the successful completion of the doctoral degree by numerous African Americans and peoples of African descent throughout his academic appointments at the University of California at Los Angeles and at the State University of New York at Buffalo. During the academic year 1979-1980, Dr. Asante served as a visiting professor at the Howard University School of Communications, where he made significant contributions toward the establishment of its newly initiated doctoral program as one of the major such programs in the nation. I should also boast at this point that Howard University School of Communications produces the largest number of PhDs of African American descent of any university in the country, and I think you should give our dean and our School of Communications a round of applause. Dr. Asante established the first doctoral program in African American studies at Temple University in 1988. He has authored or co-authored more than 28 books and more than 100 articles. Earlier in his career, he published such works as Intercultural Communication Theory into Practice, Transracial Communication, and Language, Communication, and Rhetoric in Black America. In 1989, Dr. Asante published Handbook of Intercultural and International Communication. In 1990, he published The Afrocentric Idea, and he recently co-authored the first cultural atlas of African Americans called Historical and Cultural Atlas on African Americans, which traces the movement of people from the African continent throughout the United States. He has published articles in more than 30 major periodicals, such as Newsweek, the New York Times, Jet, Africa, the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Herald Dispatch, the New York Times Book Review, and approximately 50 college and university papers have interviewed Dr. Asante or written about his works. He is indeed the founding editor of the Journal of Black Studies. Following his lecture, Dr. Asante will accept a limited number of questions. I now present to you Dr. Asante.
Thank you. Hotep. Yim Hotep. I'm delighted to be here at the Citadel of Learning in the African-American community, the great Citadel, Howard University. And I want to thank Dr. Latner for her introduction, for the invitation to appear here. Dr. Orlando Taylor, who in many ways is a mentor of mine, for his support over the years. I also want to thank those of you who have come to hear what I have to say. It is my understanding that there have been many others who have preceded me here, and some of them have had things to say that I would like to try to correct today. In addition to that, I want to thank the ancestors whose child I am, and the elders whose son I am, and in whose path I walk. Because the Africans who are here in this country and who are alive here now are the children of the ones who could not be killed. We represent in America the great statement, in fact, an emphatic statement of the will of African people not only to live, but also to help to harmonize the universe. I want to start at the beginning so as to make certain that my rhetoric teachers and my composition teachers might be pleased. Because they have always said you have to start at the beginning and go to the middle and then conclude. So I want to start at the beginning. And the beginning for me today is the question of the definition of Afrocentricity. You have heard, or perhaps you have read, much of what has been written in the media about Afrocentricity. A lot of what you have heard and what you've read has been misguided. In fact, it has absolutely been a distortion of the Afrocentric idea. The Afrocentric idea, as a theoretical idea, emerged in 1980 with the publication of my first book on that subject, Afrocentricity, The Theory of Social Change. Two subsequent books, The Afrocentric Idea and Kemet, Afrocentricity and Knowledge, further elucidated the idea that African people must be viewed as subjects of human experience and not merely on the margins of Europe. Let me explain. Afrocentricity is a simple idea. It is that there is nothing more correct than to understand that African people are agents, are actors, and are subjects in human history. We're not merely on the periphery of Europe, nor on the margins of human history. But this definition has often been lost in the discussion and in the debate about the future of African-American ideas, about African ideas and African people. No people can ever rise to any position of analysis or understanding unless they see themselves in some position of ownership of their own experiences. Otherwise, we are dislocated. We become otherwise merely fringe people. And so the definition is clear. It is a quality of seeing African people as subjects of human phenomena, as agents in our own right. It, of course, gives accountability and responsibility. This definition is not a black version of Eurocentricity. While it is natural for people of European heritage and background to have motifs and ideas and concepts which come out of their culture, that is natural and normal normally. But what has happened to Eurocentricity is that it has become an ethnocentric view. It has become the promotion of a particular experience as if that experience is universal. So the European view of music, if you say classical music, normally most people are referring in their own heads to European concert music, because the Europeans have taken over all the space of classical. You don't think of classical Akan, or classical Yoruba, or classical Japanese. The idea is that when you say classical, you're talking European. That is the promotion of the European idea as if it is a universal idea, as if it is the only human idea. So when you say classical dance, and you mean by classical dance ballet, you have then simply put everyone else on the fringes. Well, Afrocentricity is not a black version of that. It is not the imposition of an Africa-centered idea or an Afrocentric idea as if it is universal. It simply says that in all things, it is better for African people to be able to look at reality and the world through our own experiences. This is true, of course, for the Latino. It is also true for the Asian, for the Native American. The concept of Afrocentricity is one that promotes pluralism without hierarchy. The idea that it is possible in human society for you to have plural views and plural perspectives and a multiplicity of centric ideas and notions without having hegemony. And this is what we have had in an ethnocentric promotion of Europe. The European experience has become a hegemonic experience. In effect, it is the promulgation of a monocultural symbol system and a monocultural perspective on a multicultural society. There's incongruence in that. It cannot work. It does not work. It is only when African people see themselves as centered that we can begin to have some general understanding of what we all bring to the human table. Now, I raise this question first, this question of definition, because I will do some digressions and I will make some parables and give some proverbs, as is customary in my tradition. However, it is important that we start here so you can see that Afrocentricity is not an ethnocentric view. It is not the valorization of the Afrocentric point of view as if it is the only one. It is simple in its intent and also in its direction. And that is that you cannot examine African phenomena through European eyes and expect to have anything that relates to the truth. Let me raise it in another way, because I think this is very important. When David Livingstone was in Africa, in the central part of Africa, and they sent Stanley from New York to look for him, Stanley goes looking for Livingstone, and he finds him, Mr. Livingstone, I presume, and in the heart of Africa, two white men, lost white men, become, in the perspective of history, the central part of the history of Central Africa. In the midst of a million people, the Razvi, in the midst of the Chokwe people, carrying on their activities and living out history, two lost white men become the interest of people who study Central Africa. That is nonsense. It is only the promotion of the European experience as if it is the only human experience that's worth studying. Let me put it to you another way, because it's important that we see this. The African-American student who sits in a classroom in college or in high school in this country normally sits inside the classroom, but is outside of the content of the information. There is little organic relationship between the subject and that student's historical experiences. In fact, the educational experience in America presumes that there is very little connection between mathematics and African people, or politics and African people, or psychology and African people, except as objects, but not as subjects, not as agents, not as creators or actors. What is the relationship between African people and literature and art? These are significant questions. Our students are rarely given ownership of ideas. They simply become renters of white information. Renters of white information in a society that has developed and constructed an elaborate white self-esteem curriculum and has promoted that curriculum as if it is human and universal. And it is merely the particular experience of a particular people. Now I raise these questions in order to be able to proceed. When Africans were brought from the continent of Africa, and remember, no slaves were ever brought to this continent. No slaves were ever brought to the Caribbean. Africans were brought. African people were brought. These were farmers. They were fishermen and fisherwomen. They were iron smelters and blacksmiths. They were artists and musicians and dancers, translators and diplomats, officials of government, members of royal families. Africans were brought to America and enslaved in America. But how do you make a slave? How do you create a slave? The African who got off the boat in this country got off the boat not as an African American. We got off the boat as Africans from over 100 different African ethnic groups. And the person who gets off the boat and says, my name is Obadike, or my name is Tobolayefa, is getting off of the boat with certain attitudes and ideas structured by historical experiences on the continent of Africa. But when we said my name was Obadike, the white man said, I'm going to call you Bill. When the woman said, my name is Tobolayefa, they said, I'm going to call you Mary. The process of seasoning, I call it, in some of the essays that I have written, the Clarenceization process. That process it is the process of taking away from you all that you know and all that you have and giving to you a 244-year historical experiences and stopping at that. And you have a slave history. And you have historical amnesia. And so consequently, when you say, or when we said we spoke five languages, they said, no, Africans don't speak languages, you speak dialects. When we said, my religion is Akan, my religion is Yoruba, they said, you don't have religions, you got cults. When we said, I remember at the University of San Kore, the first university, modern university, I remember that at the University of San Kore, Ahmed Baba wrote 42 books on different subjects. They said, well, Africans never had universities. You said, I remember reading in Masalik Absad Masalik that El Omari says that Abu Bakari, the king of Mali in 1311, sent 100 boats out across the Atlantic in 1312. He resigned his throne and he went himself. And they said Africans never sent boats across the Atlantic. And after 244 years, we were a people dislocated, disoriented, decentered, move completely off of terms. Not merely the physical terms of movement from the continent of Africa, a moving off of the continent of Africa, but out of psychological terms, cultural terms. In fact, the other day, I met someone who thought, an African, who thought we came here on the Mayflower. So removed from his own historical experiences. And of course, he is not the only one like that. I tell the story, some of you have read it in Afrocentricity, of the gentleman who saw me with some Ghanaian kente cloth on. And he came and he said, "Brother, I used to wear that too when I was in my ethnic phase." And meanwhile, he was standing talking to me with a Scottish plaid scarf on. I said, "You're still in your ethnic phase. It just depends on whose ethnicity. All things are cultural. All things are created and developed out of cultural experiences and contexts. We either are wearing Italian suits or Korean shirts, or we're wearing Ghanaian kente. All things are cultural. But the idea is that the African has been made to feel marginal, peripheral, on the fringes of human history. When in fact, if you take archaeological evidence or biological evidence, as far as we know, whether you take the work of the Leakeys or the work of Rebecca Cann and her colleagues, the human race, as far as we know, begins on the continent of Africa. The earliest civilizations we know are on that continent. The first people who decided what was edible and what was not had to be those people. How to live together in community had to be those people. To see what was beyond a stand of trees had to be those people. The earliest communities had to be those along the Nile Valley. The Nile River is 4,100 miles long. It's longer than it is from here to California. It runs wholly in the continent of Africa. It doesn't cross Asia, it doesn't cross Europe, it doesn't cross North America or South America. It is wholly in Africa. It is an African river. The earliest civilizations we know are from that region. I'll come back to that in a minute, but I want to just introduce another thing so that my rhetoric teacher might be happy. And that is point two. Point two after the beginning. And that point, this point is stated this way. Much of what we have in terms of the educational experience of the West is based on a dogma which sits at the very head of everything. And that dogma goes something like this. Philosophy is the highest science. Philosophy came to the world through the Greeks. The Greeks are Europeans. The Greeks are Westerners. No other people gave the world philosophy or reason but the Greeks, the Europeans, the Westerners, the white people. In fact, I saw one high school textbook in New Jersey which had a line which says, "The Greeks invented reason." It is probably in your books too. But this is the dogma. That's the fundamental dogma. It is my contention that that dogma sits at the head of the whole notion of white supremacy. Because regardless of whatever else you touch, if you cannot deal with this construction, which is an artificial construction, in terms of the question of reason and rational thought, and philosophy, you are really saying that only people who really can think are white people. Look at it. They don't say that the Chinese invented philosophy. They say the Chinese invented sayings. their thoughts, the sayings of Confucius, the thoughts of Lao Tzu, but not philosophy. Philosophy is European, it's Greek, it's white. The Africans may have given to the world religion and myth, but not philosophy. Philosophy is reserved. It is white, it's European, it's Western. Native Americans may have given the world cosmogonies, but not philosophy. Philosophy belongs to Europe. You have to really think to come up with philosophy. Nobody else can do that. Reason, rational thought. But look at this. When you begin to examine the dogma, you discover that not only is the dogma incorrect, but that philosophy is not even a Greek word, nor is it an Indo-European word. In fact, according to the Dictionary of Etymology, it says that the origin of this word is unknown. And as an Afrocentrist, of course, that means I will go look. Philosophy comes from two roots, philo and sophia. Philo meaning lover of, or brother of, sophia meaning wise or wisdom. And when you began to examine history, and of course for me, I went and looked in Africa. I figure that since Africa was a place, the birthplace of the human race and the oldest civilization, let's go look at the beginning. Lo and behold, in 2052 BCE, there is an inscription on the tomb of Antef that has a long discussion of Seba. This is a transliteration of an ancient Egyptian word, Seba, meaning the wise. The wise goes in this way and not that way. The wise answers these questions and not those questions. The wise understands this and not that. And the wise gets up early in the morning and so on. Long discussion of the wise, a discussion of the philosopher. And you know what? 2052 BCE is about 1400 years before there was the first Greek philosopher. The first Greek philosopher was Thales, who lives around 600 BCE. And Thales, according to Plutarch and Plutarch's Lives, Thales says to Pythagoras, who was about 19 years old, a young man who went to him, said, "Teach me all you know. Give me all your information." And Thales looked at Pythagoras and said, "I am an old man. You must do as I have done and go and learn philosophy from the Africans." Plutarch's Lives. The second Greek philosopher of note was Isocrates. He writes, around the 5th century BCE, in a book called Busiris, named for the African deity Osiris, from the city of Busiris. He writes in Busiris that I learned not only philosophy, but medicine from the Africans. Both Thales and Isocrates, two of the earliest Greek philosophers that we know of, were students of the Africans. Question is, why then don't we begin the teaching of philosophy from the Africans? Why don't we learn the teachings of Kununuk and Patahotep and Winnie and Winamon? Pepe the First, Keti. These are the earlier philosophers. We don't get Greek philosophy until 600 BCE, and they call it ancient. It is not ancient. If we take even the uniting of the Nile Valley under Menes, 3200 before the Christian era, what we come up with is an understanding that that uniting of the Nile Valley was really, after many years, maybe thousands of years, of development along the valley, because we know there were 16 kings before Menes established the first dynasty. But he establishes the first dynasty in 3200 BCE. There is no Greece. There is no Rome or Germany or France or Britain. There's none of that. No civilizations in Europe at the establishment of the United Kingdom of the now. By 2500 BCE, most of the pyramids had already been built. The 80 great ones had just about been completed. 2,500 years before there was to be a Jesus Christ, the Africans had completed the building of the pyramids. And there was no Greece. Now, of course, you can argue that the Africans built the pyramids irrationally. You can say they built it without reason, because the Greeks hadn't got here to invent reason yet. You can say that the temples and the tombs and the shrines that were erected, you can say that all of this was built really with no reason at all. If you say that, of course, we would know exactly who you are and what you are. You know, when you are boxed in to a Eurocentric framework, it doesn't allow you to think outside of it. And that's why I say to students, when you're in classes, you have to take two sets of notes. You've got to take one set of notes to pass the exam. You got to take another set of notes to retain your sanity. And in that set of notes, you take them in the margins. And you write, I got to check this out. I don't believe this. I'm going to examine this. This person doesn't know anything about Africa. Never read African history. How can they make... You got to do that for yourself. Because if you buy that into your psychological system, then what you will discover is that you will be so dislocated and decentered that in the end of everything, you will be insane. And then when people walk up to you and say, hi, African, you look at them and say, ain't no African. You know, remember when Malcolm was talking about Africa, sister stood up in the audience and said, Malcolm, I didn't leave nothing in Africa. He said, woman, you left your mind in Africa. And why did he say that? Why did Malcolm say that? Malcolm said that because what he understood was that American is a citizenship. It's a nationality. There's no contradiction between your origin, your historical origin, and your nationality, your citizenship. There doesn't have to be. But for many of us, because we are decentered and dislocated, we assume that you can't be African and be an American. Meanwhile, all my students who are Italians can be Italians and Americans. The Vietnamese students can be Vietnamese and American. But the African say, I ain't no African. That's dislocation. And it's dislocation that is based on a psychological war that has taken place since the African was first called Bill, when the African landed in Virginia. Let me explain, because this is very important here, that if you look at 2200 to 1800 before the Christian era, you get the Harappa civilization, the civilization of Mohenjo-Daro in India. You still don't have the Greeks. We only get the Greeks with Homer in a voice that we can understand. And this is Homer and the Iliad. Divine muse, speak to me of the riotous wrath of Achilles, Peleus' son, of how he caused 10,000 Greeks to lose their souls and their bodies to be eaten by the birds and the dogs. Begin where they quarreled, proud Achilles and Agamemnon, king of men. Now, we could go on with that, but Agamemnon, we know, was an Ethiopian. But beyond that, let me just say this, that we start there, and they assume that that's the beginning of human history. You find, from Homer, you find a Greek everywhere. If you're in drama, you find Sophocles or Aeschylus. If you're in political science, you go back to Plato and the Republic. If you, whatever field, if you're in medicine, you go to Hippocrates. If you're in history, you go to Herodotus and so forth. There's a Greek everywhere, in every discipline. Because what they tried to do was to close it off. But of course, Homer was not very deep. And in fact, Homer was, of course, a student of the Africans. The first Greek voice you hear According to Herodotus, he also studied in Africa. Now, this raises some interesting questions. Again, why is it in our educational experience we are not alerted to African knowledge and information? I will tell you why. Because in the 15th century, with the rise of the European slave trade, you get also the rise of information about Africa and about the world that was racist, that was pejorative against Africans, and that tried to justify the enslavement of African people. How did this justification come about? It came about because it was necessary for these Christian Europeans to say, there is no civilization on the continent of Africa, you know, so we've got to civilize them. And the enslavement of Africans really is about civilizing them. This was the idea. This was the angle of thought. So that 300 years of negative writing about African people appeared in every book, in every subject, in every field. They created fields for us to write negative stuff about us. Phrenology. Phrenology was the study of the shape of the skull. Because they could tell by the shape of our skulls that we couldn't think. This was a science the Europeans created. Phrenology. They created another one. The theory of purpose and ends. Teleology. It is the purpose of the African to serve the white man. And even some of your most respected European writers were racist and wrote on this. Thomas Carlyle, according to the Cambridge History of English Literature, who was the moral voice of his time, wrote, after he wrote the French Revolution, after he wrote that book, which we respect, in 1853 he wrote a book called An Occasional Discourse on the Nigger Question. And what did Carlyle say? He said in it that it was the duty of the African as a loyal breed to serve the white man. And he had a lot of reasons for this. Look at this. Hegel, the great German thinker, perhaps the most quoted European writer since Plato. Hegel writes in 1828, "Let us forget Africa, never to return to it because it is outside of history." Now I'm asking you, what does all of this information, what does this do for the mind of Europe? What does it do for our own minds as Africans? It is a disorienting legacy. It is a legacy that falsifies African history, distorts European history, and promotes a hegemonic European worldview. It cannot work. It does not harmonize this society, nor can it harmonize any society. And the only reason it seemed to have worked for some people like Arthur Schlesinger Jr., whom I debated not long ago, is because there was a period when Africans had very little voice. During the period of enslavement, we were 244 years working from can't see in the morning to can't see at night. Didn't have time to study, couldn't read, couldn't write, because it was against the law in most states. So consequently, we had no voice. And while we had no voice, the promotion of negative attitudes and negative ideas regarding the African world went on unabated. You see, not only did they use phrenology and teleology to hold this in place, but anthropology became the most racist of all the disciplines. It was created basically for the purpose of showing through comparison how the European was greater, more perfect, than all other human species. This was the idea behind anthropology. The Anthropological Society of London, even in the 19th century, devoted a lot of space to supporting the notions of white superiority and white supremacy. So it was a movement. And it's a movement of knowledge and information. But more critically, it was the work of Wilhelm von Humboldt and Friedrich von Humboldt, the two German brothers of the University of Göttingen, that really created a structure that would box in American education. They developed in the 1700s something called the hierarchy of races. The Aryans at the top, the Alpines next, the Mediterraneans next, and then the Africans and the Asians somewhere below. But they didn't have depth. The Aryans didn't have depth. There was no history to it. So what these writers did was to try to find some ancient Aryans. And so they leaped over the contemporary Greeks, because they considered them Mediterraneans, and went back to Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle and said these were the direct ancestors of the Aryans. It is the same system that was later imposed in America. That is the Greek system. It is the German-Greek tyranny on Western education. Because, of course, there had been a strong emphasis on the quadrivium and the trivium and the Latin-based schools before. People did declamations, and there was a big notion about the whole liberal education idea and so on. But then with the imposing of this intellectual tyranny on Western education and the Western academy, what happened was that in America, it came out in what I call the Neo-Greek revivalism. But this Neo-Greek revivalism in America was manifested first in the South. You had the antebellum houses, the big plantation houses with Greek columns. Now, some of us here at Howard, I know that they are Egyptian, but we won't get into that's a whole other lecture. I have to come back and talk about the Egyptian influences on American society, but that's something different. But those antebellum houses, they call them Greek. Neo-Greek, neoclassical, because they were reaching back, trying to find a connectedness between, and particularly in the South, between their version of democracy, which was enslavement of African people, while they said they believed in certain ideals that were like the Greeks, because the Greeks did the same thing, they could do some of the same things, right? This was a big period. Banks, churches, all had these Greek columns. Big 18th century, big 19th century movement in the 1800s. This was the rise of the fraternities, the Greek organizations, the Greek letter organizations. Big, big idea going on in the 19th century. The Ku Klux Klan, Ku Klux Klan, Ku Klux, Greek word for circle. I mean, all of this was going, it was a big movement. Now, why was this movement going on? What was necessary here? It was necessary to put a psychological hold on something that had occurred at the top of the 19th century. And that is how to explain the fact that they had lied for 300 years about Africa. Because in 1799, when Napoleon's army, the Grand Army, went into Egypt, they found on the African continent, not in Asia, not in Europe, not in America, they found on the African continent a civilization that was more majestic and monumental than Greece and Rome combined. The question is, what do you do with this information? How do you explain it? 100 writers were taken along with the army. They were under the leadership of Dominique Vivant Desnoyers. Desnoyers' purpose and charge was to record everything they saw. Write it down. Illustrate, draw the outlines of the temples and the tombs, make maps, do all of this. The pen is mightier than the sword, said Napoleon. And when they completed their work, they had the largest book that had ever been written. It was the description of Egypt. It was called the world's first encyclopedia. What do you think happened when this information hit the academies of the West. There was outrage on some people's part. I mean, how can this be? Here is a civilization that's more ancient than Greece. Not only more ancient, there's more written material about it. The Africans wrote more. They wrote on everything. They wrote on all the walls. They wrote everywhere. So what do we do with this? You know what the first thing they said? Egypt is not in Africa. In fact, I asked a middle school class in the city of New York, a state, last year to tell me where Egypt was. And most of them thought it was in Europe. But you can look at the map, right? We don't even need to go through that. I don't need to have that discussion with students in college, right? I mean, you can look at the map. Go look at the map if you think you need to look at. You can find out which continent it's on. Between Kenya and Egypt is one country. You can go over land from Ghana to Egypt. You don't even have to cross any water. And yet this idea of this separation of the classical history of Egypt, of Africa, from the rest of the African continent, was attempted by taking Egypt out of Africa. Of course, they couldn't do that. So when they couldn't do that, they tried to take black people out of Egypt. They said, okay, Egypt is in Africa, but the ancient Egyptians were not black people. And then, of course, when they read Herodotus, who writes in histories that the people of another place called Colchis must be Egyptians because, like the Egyptians, they have black skin and woolly hair. Or when they read Aristotle in Physiognomonica, who says that the Egyptians and the Ethiopians are very black. Or when they read Diodorus Siculus and others, Greeks, they revised it a little bit. They said, it is true as the ancient, this is what the Egyptologists did in the 19th century. They said, it is true as the ancient Greeks said, that the ancient Egyptians had black skin and woolly hair, but they were not Negroes. Well, of course, Negro is a creation. I've been to Africa 22 times. I've never yet met one. I haven't had anyone who said my language was Negro or my ethnic group is Negro or my village is Negro. Doesn't exist. It's a white creation, and it was created for Africans who had been enslaved. People have ethnic identities. They are Shona, they are Beja, they are Gala, they are Yoruba, Wolof, Mandinka, they're Asante and Fanti, and Eve and Gan. I mean, you can't, I mean, people don't say there's no such thing. But that is what we are led to believe when we read what these white writers of ancient Africa have written. Then some of them said, it is true that they were black-skinned and had woolly hair, but they were black-skinned whites. The guy who wrote that was Maspero. He said, they're black-skinned whites. Now I went all up and down the Nile Valley looking for them because I wanted to see them. Now y'all may have some here in Washington, but I didn't see it in these black-skinned whites. There was no way. I couldn't find them. So the idea here is to create something which is not real. It's unreal, totally unreal. The question is, what did they do? How did they handle ancient classical Africa? You know what they did? In the latter part of the 19th century at Princeton, at all of the museums in the West, at Penn, University of Pennsylvania, at the Sorbonne, at the University of London, at Berlin, and in all the great museums of the West, they created another category for ancient classical Africa. They call it Oriental Studies. So if you look for Egypt, you can't look under Africa because the West played a trick. And their trick was to take ancient Africa out of Africa and to put it, ancient African civilization out of Africa and to put it under Oriental studies or Near Eastern studies. And so what you have is an accommodation that was made largely because of the fact that Egypt, in a contemporary sense, was being occupied by Arabs who came into Egypt in the 7th century AD, 641 AD. Arabic is not an indigenous language to Egypt, nor are the Arabs indigenous people to Egypt. They overlaid Egypt with the language, the religion, and the culture. The ancient black people of Egypt who painted themselves on the walls of tombs and temples had a history that was 4,000 years old when the Arabs came. In fact, on the tomb of Ramses III, there's the world's first ethnology in which the Egyptians painted themselves and the Ethiopian both as very black. And when you go to Egypt, you will see for yourself that when you go into the temples and when you get to Luxor and you're going further into the country, the people get to be coal black. And the question has to be, how do we keep this information away from white people and African people in this country? We kept it away from African people largely by virtue of the structure of knowledge. There are certain things boxed in, there are certain things boxed out. There are certain people who are always grounded and organically connected to content, and there are other people who have no ownership of knowledge at all. So we assume that it has no relationship. Whatever the field, science, mathematics, geometry, astronomy, we assume it has no relationship to African history or African people. In fact, the first astronomers were Africans. The first people in geometry were Africans. The first people in medicine were Africans. The first people in literature were Africans. They gave the world all of this. And the connection to the rest of the African world is the migrations from the eastern part of Africa were migrations that led to all the peopling of the continent. Sheikh Anta Diop, the very great scholar, perhaps one of the greatest scholars of the 20th century, wrote that until Africans dare to reconnect Egypt to the rest of Africa, the history of all African societies will hang suspended in the air. Egypt, he said, is to Africa as Greece is to Europe. Let me explain one other thing and then I will be finished. On this side, Afrocentricity simply means for us as African American people that there is nothing more correct for us than our own historical experiences. That we have all the answers and examples and illustrations that are necessary for our own fulfillment in life. And to say that is not to say that we do not share and interact in the grand march of the world. What it is to say is that we bring something to the table. Otherwise, what we bring to the table is nothing more than a distorted version of Europe. We become imitative white people coming to the table to discuss with white people ideas of the world. Cannot be. Our ancestors cry in their graves. Their voices are heard that it is now time for African people to see the accountability and the responsibility in being subjects of our own history, being centered. At the end of the Civil War in 1865, 4.5 million Africans were emancipated. We had fought for it. 186,000 Africans had fought for our liberation. And when we were freed with nothing. We had nothing, not a dime, not a nickel. If we had clothes, the clothes didn't belong to us. If we had shoes, they didn't belong to us. There'd been a great discussion in this country about how unethical it was to work people for 244 years for free and then not give them anything, just let them go free. The U.S. Congress refused to give us 40 acres of land and a mule. But they said, you're free, you're equal now. But in 1865, whites had just about sold up the country. They had all of it. In 1849, they had gone to get all the gold from California, the 49ers. Africans were still enslaved in 49. So when we were freed absolutely with nothing. No mule, no acre of land, nothing. And that is why I say, never forget that no people have come as far as African people have come in this society against such incredible odds. You can never forget that our great, great grandfathers and mothers walked for 20 and 30 miles to the nearest school that they could find to be educated. To sit sometimes in a classroom by a 12-year-old so that they could learn how to read the Bible before they die. We went looking for our brothers and our sisters after the war. Our uncles, our mothers, our fathers, people trying to put their families back together because they'd been sold to different slave owners. And in looking for each other, we began to say, hey, brother, hey, sister, knowing that it could be correct. And that is why James Weldon Johnson is so correct. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat have not our weary feet brought us to the place for which our parents sighed. We have come over a way that with tears have been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out of the gloomy past till now we stand at last where the white gleam of our bright star is cast.
Dr. Asante, I'm sure that I speak for all of the students, faculty, staff, and other members of the university community, as well as others who've come today to hear what has been one of the most thought-provoking, stimulating lectures that in this academic affairs lecture series. Dr. Asante will now take questions from the audience, and he will field his own questions.
10 minutes, because I know.
Okay. We will take a limited number of questions for the next 10 minutes. Then we have to move on with its schedule. Thank you.
All right. One, two, three. Right. Yes. Please make them brief, okay? Right.
Dr. Asante, I just wanted to comment briefly and to ask you a question based on the talk that you gave, you'll recall, at the University of South Carolina. And in fact, you indicated that you have to reject the negative aspects of European culture that have been aggressive or arrogant toward other cultures, transcend the pejoratives of Africa that give out of European history, and fill in the gaps of the students' knowledge of Africa.
Yes.
I think that that would have been in the educational conference at the University of South Carolina.
Well, thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Okay, the one thing about that is that in terms of rejecting the pejoratives, what we have to do actually is to examine almost everything that's in the curriculum in the West. See, because if we don't, if we just infuse it without examining it, we will still keep the same structures. I'll give you an example, is that, as the gentleman was mentioning about the University of South Carolina conference, the question of calling Africans Hottentots and Bushmen, for example, you can't keep that in anybody's language. Or speaking of African ethnic groups as tribes while speaking of European ethnic groups as ethnic groups. You can't do that. Because if you do it, you're falling right into the box that was created by the racist who created a system that was ethnocentric in the first place to valorize the European experience. To make this situation such that the European experience is seen alongside everybody else and not above everybody means that you've got to take out all the pejoratives against people, negative statements, statements that I've heard teachers say, even about Native Americans, talk the children, for example, acting like a bunch of wild Indians and things like that. You've got to take all that stuff out. You've got to cleanse it. In fact, multiculturalism, the next level after multiculturalism, is anti-racist teaching. See, I believe in anti-racist education. I think that multicultural is a good start, but we've got to move beyond that to having anti-racist teaching, because the society was constructed on a racist basis. The educational system was never designed for Africans. It was not set up for it. And some schools still haven't responded to the fact that you have Africans in them in any way. There are certain schools that still sing Dixie, have Confederate mascots, teach a white self-esteem curriculum, even though there are black children in those schools. What that means is that those black children are being severely damaged. So yes, that's my response to that. Okay? All right? Yes, sir. Okay, I'm sorry, brother, you're kind of slow. Go right ahead.
Okay. You said that after going through your whole speech and reading your book, Afrocentricity, you realize that it's a pretty powerful concept which you're trying to, in which to understand. But once you do understand that, I think it's important to go about utilizing what you've learned for the betterment of yourself and your people. So could you explain a little bit about Nijia and the way?
Nijia. Nijia, the concept of Nijia is a notion that actually is a family notion that was developed around the concept of communal gatherings, where people began to discuss with each other and to share information with each other so that there is a useful development of community. And Nijia, and I've written in Afrocentricity, that Nijia was a good beginning point for us, because part of our problem, I think, in this society is that we also are bombarded by various images and so on that really create real dissonance. And I was in a black church not long ago, and I said to the deacon, I said, well, you know, we really ought to be dealing with the question of these symbols that you got in here flying around in the air. And why don't we put some kente cloth up? And he said, oh, brother, can't do that. That's real pagan. And there was nothing more pagan than what he was doing, but he didn't understand that. So part of it is, again, the consciousness is you know, we got to develop the consciousness. And Nijia is one of the steps to develop that consciousness. Yes, sir.
I am a graduate student in the history department. My name is Fleetwood. I'm very pleased that you came here to speak with us, Brother Asante. Now, my question has to do with theoretical limits, and it's a question from my heart. Given the premise that African culture, or that human culture, stemmed from the African continent, and indeed the species is, as we know so far, from the African continent, is it then reasonable to extend the limits of Afrocentricity to include all of human culture and the whole species?
Well, the only answer to that, of course, is to say that African origins certainly extend to the whole human family. But the concept of Afrocentricity is a limited concept, which simply is giving agency to people of African descent. Now, somebody else could develop another theory, which could certainly do that, but that's not my theory. You know what I'm saying? That's why I always tell people, when you talk about Afrocentricity, always explain which theorist are you talking about and who said what. And what are you going to... So no, my idea of Afrocentricity is the centrality of African people and human experience to give us agency. All right? Thank you. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and that's it, I guess, right? And 7. We're finished quickly, right?
So you mentioned Napoleon's intrusion into Egypt. I've heard that Napoleon was responsible for blowing the nose off of the Sphinx. Is that true?
I've heard that he was responsible for that, too. I've never read that. I don't know where that's from. Thank you. Yes.
Hotep Baba.
Hotep.
Do you see us ever recognizing them? And you know who I'm talking about as what they are, African albinos? Are we ever going to get to the point of recognizing that they are not really Europeans, but Africans who are albinos?
Well, let's put it this way. That, and this is, goes right back to the question the brother asked here. All human beings that we know of on the earth did come from the continent of Africa. And I definitely, as far as we know, historically and scientifically, there is some dispute now about China, but as far as we know, most people claim Africa. And in that sense, people in Europe, people in Asia, are also, in a sense of the monogenesis theory, are derived from the continent of Africa. So that would be my answer to that. I must say this, I'm not a melanist, because I am much more concretely involved in the question of social and political and cultural, spiritual construction and reconstruction. All right. Okay. Yes.
I read like Schlesinger and Vavage and all the people are saying, no, you're not doing it. And I wanted to know, are there any scholars on the continent who are buying into your work, and what are their names? Because we see all this stuff on the Western side, and I'm wondering, are they picking it up on the continent?
Yes.
And the second question is, Kershaw, a guy at the University of Washington, is using your paradigm and saying that has a historical materialism, and that doesn't parallel with the stuff I've read with what you've said, so I want you to address that too.
Okay, well, in terms of the first question, certainly, I speak a lot in Africa. And there are a number of African people and organizations that are doing a lot. Just for starters, you ought to read all of Chinwezu's work. Chinwezu is, you know, there are some things I disagree with, but mainly Chinwezu's the West and the rest of us, the colonization, decolonization of the African mind by Chinwezu, Chinweizu. Also, you can certainly read all the works of Obenga, Teofil Obenga, O-B-E-N-G-A, who is a real close friend and scholar, colleague. There are a number of works and a number of people, not just here, but also in Brazil, Abdias do Nascimento's work from Brazil, which is Afrocentric work, taking the Afro-Brazilian notion of the quilombo and moving from there. And then also in the West Indies, there are scholars and writers. In England now, there are a number of people, Paul Ugbana. So there are people all over who are doing this work. And at Temple University, we have a faculty of 11, and we have the only PhD program in African American Studies, and we have 200 graduate students studying for the MA and the PhD at Temple. And our faculty is engaged in this process. Just about every faculty member is engaged in the Afrocentric paradigm and work. Yes, sir.
I'm a teacher of rhetoric and argumentation here, and I want to know what kind of texts that you mentioned, you know, African texts on philosophy and logic, have been codified, and what languages are they in, so that if we have to implement them here, because we only have the Aristotle and Plato around here. So I wanted to know, could you mention any of these texts and what languages are they in, and, you know, how would we have to translate them?
Most of this work has already been translated by Breasted and by Budge, and some you may disagree with some of the translations, but and also Lichtheim. I mean, much of this work is already translated. It's just that people don't start with them. So what I would do if I were you, I would look at all the work on ancient Egypt. I'm doing a book for Temple Press this year, which is called Sources of the African Tradition. I'm editing this book with Dr. Abu Abari. And this book will be a massive work with all of the ancient African sources included, as many as we can. It won't be all of them, but certainly we will include the major ones from ancient Egypt as well as ancient Ethiopia, Aksum. So there will be a volume, but and I must tell you, there's a lot of stuff. I mean that we need. I'm sorry, I thought I missed someone. Okay, one and then one last one, I guess. Yes.
I have a question in terms of the phrase African American. I don't understand how one can be, because I can't call myself an American considering we're not equal here. So how do you resolve that issue with being African American?
Well, I think that Maulana Karenga is correct on this question, that part of it, of course, is your domicility, where you're domiciled, and you're domiciled in America. and many of us have been born here. And so I don't have any problem with that, because American does recognize the notion of citizenship. It's your passport you carry. It is your nationality and that kind of thing. So I thought you were going to make another argument, which the people from South America always make, and they're correct on it. How can we in the United States claim to be African Americans? I mean, what are the people in Brazil? We really are really African United Statesians, you know, I mean, that kind of thing. So we use that word a little loosely. But I think that the citizenship of the United States of America, I don't find that problematic. I mean, some people say we move toward African, and I've often said that too. But if we're here, we're here. I mean, we are Africans here. And there is something to the fact that the African American is a unique, in the United States, is a uniquely different African ethnic group with a history that's different from the Yoruba. You see, because the Yoruba heroes and heroines are different from ours, but we share in them all in a Pan-African sense. But actually, there's a history. The Jamaican history is different. You see, the Haitian history is different. So there are these histories of African people, and we are a composite of all these African ethnic groups, plus a large proportion of Native American and some European in the African-American population. In fact, the African-American population is the most diverse population in America. So that amalgamation means that we are, in that sense, a unique and a different African ethnic group. I want to thank you very much. I've enjoyed speaking here at Howard. Thanks.
I have two announcements. I'd like to make two quick announcements. This lecture was taped by C-SPAN. If you will tune into C-SPAN tonight, they will have on the schedule when it will be telecast. I'd also like to announce to you that next month in our academic affairs lecture series, Gerald Prothrow, a Howard graduate who is with IBM, will speak on the impact of science and technology on African Americans in the 21st century. In April, Bell Hooks and Cornell West will talk about the dialogue between the sexes. Thank you very much.
This speech was delivered on Wednesday as part of Howard University's Academic Affairs Distinguished Lecture Series. You can send your comments to Howard University at 1400 Shepherd Street Northeast, Washington, D.C., 20017. Now, coming next, we will update our program schedule. From the nation's capital, this is C-SPAN 2. The cable satellite public affairs networks are non-profit, non-partisan cooperatives privately funded by America's cable television companies. We pause now to update our program schedule for you. And coming next, an organization known as the Presidential Classroom will hold a discussion regarding U.S. defense issues. We'll hear from the number two man at the Joint Chiefs of Staff at 7:55 a.m. Eastern Time, 4:55 Pacific. Defense Secretary Les Aspin will discuss American defense preparedness. We'll follow that with remarks from the new Labor Secretary, Robert Reich, as he takes part in a forum concerning jobs and the economy at North Carolina State University. Then we'll hear from the former president of Haiti, Jean-Bertrand Aristide, as he makes a speech at an event titled In Defense of Haitian Democracy. And that's a look at our program schedule here on C-SPAN 2.
The C-SPAN networks are now offering two more resources to help you keep up with the new faces of Washington. The new Members of Congress Handbook and the U.S. Congress Handbook. Both publications have photos, phone numbers, and biographies of House and Senate members, and are perfect for following C-SPAN's coverage of the 103rd Congress. Order now by calling 1-800-523-3174 and receive your new member's handbook. And later in the spring, you'll get the all-new edition of the U.S. Congress Handbook. Or you can send a check or money order for $10.95 plus $2.50 shipping and handling to C-SPAN Publications, 1616 Main Street, Lynchburg, Virginia. The zip code is 24504.
Coming next, we'll hear from Admiral David Jeremiah. He is the Vice Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The leaders of the service branches provide the main military council to the President. Admiral Jeremiah spoke on Thursday before the Presidential Classroom, which is a nonprofit group that brings outstanding high school students to the nation's capital to explore federal decision-making. Here now is our coverage from that event.
Ladies and gentlemen, our very special guest today is Admiral David Jeremiah, who is the Vice Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. In this capacity, he serves as the nation's second highest-ranking military officer. Admiral Jeremiah served on 7 Pacific Fleet destroyers, and he commanded Destroyer Squadron 24 in the late 70s. While serving as Commander Cruiser Destroyer Group 8, in the mid-80s, he commanded Task Force 60 in the Mediterranean.